There was condemnation. There was nothing but condemnation for each and every one of us outside of Christ. But now, there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. So for your lives, if you've given your life to Christ, you can say with Paul, there is no condemnation for you. Now, that's not just condemnation in the sense of somebody speaking something, somebody condemning you and saying, that's bad. Condemnation here is much more tangible, much more real. Condemnation is the execution of the judgment. It's not just the judgment. It's not just the judge wrapping the gavel and saying guilty. It is the execution of the sentence. And so what Paul is saying, there is no condemnation. There is no sentence for you to bear. There is now no sentence. Your sentence has been eradicated, destroyed by Christ Jesus for those who are in Christ Jesus. This, for the believer, is the most magnificent truth that we can experience. The most fabulous, amazing, awesome message that we can convey to anybody. That there is now, therefore, no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you are in Christ Jesus, that is a hallelujah. And if you are not in Christ Jesus, that is a please God save me. It is a call to salvation through faith. These words open our chapter and we begin to study them. We looked through that passage and we began to move on from there and we saw the reason for that no condemnation. We saw the root or the means by which that condemnation was eradicated, and we saw the result of the absence of condemnation in our lives when we studied the next three verses, 2, 3, and 4. The reason for it, well, why don't we just read it? For the law of the Spirit of life has set you free in Christ Jesus from the law of sin. The law of the Spirit of life is the gospel. The reason that we are free is because we have believed and accepted the gospel. The root by which we are saved comes next in verse 3. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do. Remember we said that the law was not weak, the law was not broken, the law was not wrong. The law was right. It was we who were weak. It was the flesh, our fallen nature. Remember, flesh is that symbolism, that imagery for our fallen nature, our sinfulness. The law, which is perfect and declares perfectly God's expectations, God's will, God's commandments for us, we couldn't do it. It couldn't save us because we were unable to obey it and abide in it and to follow it. So what the law was unable to do, God did. How? What? What did he do? He saved us, verse 3, continuing, by sending his own son in the likeness of sinful flesh for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh. So remember we said the likeness of sinful flesh was a very important phrase, that it was Jesus was like sinful flesh. He wasn't sinful flesh, and he wasn't like flesh. He was actual flesh, but without the sin. And he came for sin, it says, in order that God could condemn sin. And so sin, that condemnation, again, is more than just an oral, a verbal condemnation. It is the action, the sentence being executed on sin. Namely, that sin is destroyed in Christ Jesus for those of us who are in Christ Jesus. And finally, the result, verse 4, is that in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk according to the, not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. And so God's righteousness, God's perfect character, is maintained and upheld because God has to punish sin. He cannot leave sin go unpunished because that would be unjust. And you can, you know, we always say, well, God's merciful and he's loving. Right, you want God to be merciful and loving to the guy who hurt you. We want justice for the people who hurt us. And if you went to court and somebody, a drunk driver, killed one of your family members, and the judge said, well, I choose mercy, and this drunk driver gets nothing, you would say, where is the justice in that? God has to be just and punish sin. And so by sending Christ in the likeness of sinful flesh, Jesus takes God's punishment, and God pours out all of his punishment upon Christ so that those who are in Christ can receive the not guilty verdict and be saved. That's the result of the no condemnation, is that we do not receive God's wrath. His righteous requirement is fulfilled, and it's fulfilled in us. And the second part of that fulfilling, the fulfilling in us, means that God's righteousness is being poured out not only upon us, but into and through us, so that we are becoming more and more righteous with each passing day. We are growing in our righteousness. The Holy Spirit living in us is transforming us, and that's where we're going to pick up today, that transformation process. We're going to examine that in the next few verses that Elder Barb read for us just a few moments ago, and we're going to see what that transformation process looks like. As we read through the next few verses, one of the things that many people read here, and even some people take from it and claim from this passage, is that believers are now living sin-free existences, that they have gone on to move beyond the sinful state of life and now entered into a sin-free existence, that they no longer sin, in essence. And we know that's not true. We know that's not true. Many people will say, I know that's not true because I can just look around me. I can just look in the mirror and I can see that I haven't moved beyond sin. And I can see that my neighbor hasn't moved beyond sin. And I can definitely see that my spouse hasn't moved beyond sin. Right? Get a couple hallelujahs there. Amen. And right there, we haven't moved beyond sin. But I have to tell you, that's a really bad way of interpreting the Bible through personal experience. Personal experience is not the end-all foundation of interpretation. We know that we haven't moved beyond sin because Paul tells us in Romans chapter 7. He spent an entire chapter wrestling. Remember, we talked about how Paul wrestled with the fact that he is saved, that sin's power is broken, that he is no longer enslaved to sin, that he is dead to sin, and yet at the end of the chapter, he is still wrestling with sin. And as we study through chapter 7, Paul gets to this point where he says, the thing that I want to do, I don't do, and that which I don't want to do, I do. Oh, who will save me from this wretched body of death? Thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And we see this wrestling match going on with Paul, within Paul himself, who wrote right at the end of chapter 7, which precedes chapter 8. For those of you who aren't mathematicians, chapter 7 comes before chapter 8. And at the end of chapter 7, he says, who will save me from this body of death? Thanks be to God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. So then, he concludes the chapter, I myself serve the law of God with my mind, but with my flesh I serve the law of sin. And so this wrestling match goes on, and then he comes into chapter 8. And now he's talking about this as we read through the first few verses, and into chapter, verses 5 and following, we may get the sense that, oh, he's overcome sin. Sin's no longer part of it. But we have to remember chapter 7. We can't forget chapter 7. Paul is still wrestling with that sin. So don't interpret this to say that believers should be sin-free. And if I'm not sin-free, woe is me because I'm not a believer. Or my neighbor must not be a believer because I saw they definitely sin. Or my spouse, or my child, or my parent. Because that's not at all what Paul is saying here. It seems that way at first glance, but it's not. But let's look at it. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. We have to stop. So Paul does not say that believers are living sin-free lives. But what he is saying is that their perspective has changed. He uses this word in here, which is translated, set their minds. Set their minds. And in fact, most translators agree they translate it the same way. But in fact, that word there is a very hard word to translate. It's phroneo. And it has this idea of thinking about something, but more than thinking about it, focusing on it, meditating on it, mulling over it, really wrestling with it. It's really this whole idea of worldview, of perspective, that their minds are set on something, that they see things from a certain angle, they view things from a certain point of view, and it's consistent, and it's sort of like their own perspective. And he says there's two perspectives here. There are two mindsets. One is the things that focus on the things of the flesh. It says those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. We can think about it this way. Our hobbies, our professions, our interests, they really are the things that sort of dictate where we or how we think about things. For instance, a hunter will come and a bill will be before Congress about gun control. And a hunter may view that very differently from somebody who doesn't hunt. because they have a hunter's mindset. Now, I'm not saying that all hunters will view that bill in the exact same way, or will decide in the same, that the same action should be taken, but they come at it from a certain perspective. The teachers, when a bill is coming to Congress regarding education, we'll look at that from one perspective, from a teacher's perspective. And again, they don't all necessarily agree, but they have this perspective, this experience. Health workers, nurses, doctors, technicians, when healthcare is being discussed and debated, they have a perspective that they're coming from, and they have a vested interest in the outcome of that. And so they pay attention to that. Police will have a different viewpoint than inmates on what should happen regarding laws. You can think about this from any number of ways. Farmers have an interest, have a perspective. Lawyers have an interest. Doctors have an interest. Teachers, just think about it. All these people have a background and a perspective, a mindset that when it comes to certain issues, they have ideas that sort of guide their opinion. And they'll have much more of an opinion maybe than somebody who is less educated. Although many people have very strong opinions on things they have no knowledge about whatsoever, but they will have some sort of experience knowledge and come at something with some background. And so you can think about the mindset, the freneto, as being that sort of background. It can be hobbies or profession or experiences which kind of guide our mindset. Military people will have a background like that as well. Just think about it along those ways. Christians, Paul is saying, those who are filled with the Spirit have a particular freneto, have a particular mindset. People who are filled with the Spirit have a spiritual mindset, a mindset upon things in the Spirit. They think about things in a spiritual way. They think about things the way the Holy Spirit would think about them. And so Christians, and that's what Paul means here when he says those who are filled with the Spirit, have a spiritual mindset. They start to think about things the way that God thinks about them. Whereas on the other hand, non-Christians, unbelievers, and Paul uses the term those who are in the flesh, think about things according to the flesh. Do you remember what we said flesh means? Flesh doesn't just mean skin, because we've all got skin. Flesh describes somebody who is living in the sinful fallen nature, unredeemed by Christ. They're still living with that sinful nature, but they haven't got the Spirit changing that nature. We all are born in the flesh, but we are changed when the Holy Spirit comes and takes up residence within us, and it begins to transform us. So those who are living in the flesh, you can say those who are living in the fallen nature, those who are continuing in the fallen nature without any redemption in their lives, think about things according to the fallen nature. They think about things the way the perverted, fallen, sinful, selfish way that we are born to think about things without any change. So those are the two kind of perspectives. Now the thing that Paul gets at here is that you've got the unbeliever, which is everybody who's born into this world, thinking about things according to the flesh, and then you've got believers, which is some people in the world, believers in Jesus Christ, who have the Holy Spirit living in them, who are thinking about things according to the Spirit, the Holy Spirit. So those who are in the flesh think about things according to the flesh, those who are in the Spirit think about things according to the Spirit. The question is, how does one go from one to the other? For all this way to begin with, how do we end up over here? The idea, I think, an illustration that may help us is a really gross one. So if you've got a weak stomach, go ahead and plug up your ears. Okay? Nobody plugging? Okay. Fair, I warned you. Think about it like an eye transplant. Think about it like you've got an eye transplant. They came in and took out your eyes and replaced them with somebody else's eyes. Before the transplant, you were in the flesh. You saw things according to the flesh. You can think about it as visual impairment. Perhaps you're very nearsighted or very farsighted. Or maybe you're colorblind. Or maybe you have astigmatism. Or maybe you have cross eyes. Or maybe you're blind. And so as you are going through life, you learn to exist in this way. You see things in that warped way, in that blinded way. You get used to seeing things like that. But then along comes a doctor and says, I've got a pair of 20/20 eyes, and he takes out your eyes, and he replaces them with these brand new, perfect eyes given you this perfect 20/20 vision. At first, it's going to be hard to see things. It's going to be hard to get used to that. Those of you who never saw color are going to see a rainbow and say, oh my goodness, it is far more beautiful than I ever thought. Those of you who are nearsighted are going to still not sure what to do with your arms when you're reading a book. And those of you who need glasses when you're driving are going to look up and see the stoplight. You can think about maybe a little less gross, which is you think about corrective lenses. Maybe that's a little easier to think about. Those of you who have, like me, who need corrective lenses, without the glasses, things look a certain way. Sometimes I'm looking and I see two people, two of the same people. I better put these back on. And then you put your glasses on and you see clearly. You know, the first time I got my glasses, I thought my vision was pretty good. I went to the doctor and he showed me how clear my vision would be and I got lenses. And I said, you know, when I was in the doctor's office, everything looked a lot clearer. But I thought, well, you know, I'm doing fine without them. So I put it off a year, put it off another year. Finally, he said, you really need to get glasses if you want to be safe on the road. And so I got glasses. Well, you know the first thing I did when I had my glasses on? The very first thing, walking out of the eye doctor's, I got in my car, I drove away and ran a red light. Because I couldn't see it. Because I wasn't used to seeing so clearly. I was seeing so much. And I could see the red light, but it was almost like it was past me before I even realized it was there because I could see it so far up. I was thinking, oh, I'm through it. I don't know about it. I just ran a red light. Because my vision had been so drastically changed from without to within. And now I take it off and I feel like I'm losing my balance. When I'm at karate and we're sparring and I take off my glasses, I have to really take a few minutes to get used to seeing fuzzy again. Or else I'm sparring and I have my glasses on and then I have to really protect my face, which is dangerous. So it's like you've got to get used to it. It's a whole new vision. It's a completely different way of seeing things. And that's the idea that Paul's getting at here. He's saying we, in the flesh, saw things. We thought about things. We interpreted things in the way of the flesh. And what is the way of the flesh? The fallen, sinful nature. We interpreted things according to selfishness. We interpreted things according to perverted, sinful understanding of things. And you can think about our culture in any number of ways and see this at work, part in our culture. As our culture tells us about sexuality and how sexuality is okay, regardless of what the Bible says, we can express it in this way, or this way, or this way, or this way, or that way, or that way, or that way. It's all okay. And they believe it. Why? Because they haven't got spiritual vision that God has given to them. So they can't really see clearly. It's like the blindfold. Jeremiah says that our heart is deceitful and wicked above all else. They say you just got to believe in yourself, you got to trust yourself. No, the Bible says don't do that. Trust in me, the Lord. Trust in my word. The people of our culture say, no, trust in ourselves. And so they come up with all these strange things about all sorts of numbers of things and say, this is okay. It's all right. It doesn't matter what the Bible says. It doesn't matter what God says. Well, in fact, it's wrong. God is the only one who has the right or the authority to declare something right or wrong. And when he does, he means it. It's not just a suggestion. It's just not a brainstorm that God said, oh, maybe this. It's very clear, and it's articulated very clearly in his word. And your parents sometimes, they're dealing with kids, and their children are struggling with sin issues. And the parents will say to me, well, I can't really come down too hard on them. You know what the second line of that is? Because I did the same thing when I was their age. You've heard that before, right? That's absolutely wrong. Because our parents had come into this place and say, well, it can't be that bad because I did it. What's that say? It doesn't say that that thing that they're doing is right. It says that we were wrong. It says that when we were young, guess what? We were sinners back then. God has declared something right or wrong, and whether or not we did it, it's wrong or right, depending on what God says. And if we change that in any way, we become judgmental. You know, our culture is so happy to condemn judgmentalism. But they're very judgmental. Judgmental means that we determine what's right or wrong. And when our culture says something is right or wrong, when they say this wrong thing that the Bible says is wrong is right, that's not being gracious and merciful, that's being judgmental. They're declaring themselves as judges, saying, I am the judge. God is not the judge. I am the one who gets to determine what's right or wrong. That's judgmentalism. When we say that God says something is wrong, that's not judgmentalism. That's declaring the truth. That's declaring the way things are. That's declaring reality. That's declaring God's word. And to do anything less, that's judgmentalism. That's the definition of it. So what Paul is saying here is those in the flesh see things, understand things, think about things, interpret things according to their sinful, fallen nature, the flesh. That's how they understand life. That's how they understand the world. That's how they understand people. And that's how they make their decisions, based on that flesh. But those who are in the Spirit now have another thing altogether happening in them. They've got spiritual glasses. They've got God-shaped lenses. They've got new spiritual eyes given to them by God that helps them to interpret things in God's way, that helps them to see things as God would see them, that helps them to embrace God's perspective. Over here, God's perspective is rejected. Over here, it's embraced. Over here, the people are hostile to it. Over here, they love it. Even when they can't do it, they long for it. And that's what Paul is saying here, is that those who are of the flesh have a mindset on of flesh, and those who live according to the Spirit have a mindset on the things of the Spirit. I'm going to end here. We got through all of but one whole verse. I think that seven verses was a bit ambitious, but I was hoping to maybe get a little further, but I think this is a great place to stop. And I'm going to leave you with an assignment this week. This week, as you're going through life, as you see people, as you encounter circumstances, as you interact, as you are at work, as you are at play, each time something happens in your life, I want you to take a moment and just simply ask yourself this question. How would God see this? How would God interpret this situation? How would God act here? What would God think? Just take a moment to ask that question. If you're a believer, then that's going to guide how you respond to that situation. How you respond to what's going on. How you respond to that person. And by the way, I don't want you to just do this at work. I want you to do this with your spouse, with your children, with your friends. Do this everywhere. And just simply pause. Whatever's happening, and take a moment and pray, God, how would you see this? God, what would you do in this place, in this circumstance? How would you act? How would you respond? Then as believers, if we have an answer to that question, then we also have an answer to another question, which is how should I respond? So that's your assignment this week, and we'll pick up with verse 6 next week, and hopefully we'll make it through more than one verse together. But you know what? Studying God's word is not a sprint. It's a marathon. Let's pray, thank you. Father,